Hello, my dear friends, for attending GST Fast Track Batch. I have uploaded up to lecture number 6 and I am continuing with the remaining portions. So we have completed so far value of supply, then input tax credit, and thereafter I proceeded with returns and payment process, composition scheme, GST practitioner. So what are all the areas where there were lot of amendments? So those areas I have just covered first. And thereafter, now whatever areas I am going to discuss, we don't have that much amendments, maybe one or two only, but not many. And we already completed in the miscellaneous topic, that is in the last area, last concept block, GST practitioner, concept block 12, miscellaneous topics we completed, GST practitioner. Now there is another area in this, that is e-way bill. So please take page number 157 and continue with that. See, this e-way bill, of late many good number of questions were being asked. Even the recently released RTP for November 21 also contains a question on e-way bill. So therefore, this e-way bill concept is important. So at least for a 3 marks or an MCQ, they are asking one question. First, so what is the e-way bill about? It is a document. Who will be giving the document? That document will be filed by the person, registered person, who is causing movement of goods. Why this document needs to be given? If this document is not there, what will happen? If this document is not there, okay, how to control or how to regulate the movement of goods without a valid invoice? So what will happen? I get an order and I transport goods from one location, supplier location, to the buyer's location, and I will not raise any invoice and I will not pay any GST. This amount I will collect it in cash and I will keep it in my pocket and I will not pay GST. How to track these kind of transactions? So that's why they have actually started with the check post concept in the old indirect tax regime, that is under sales tax. But the check post leads to delay in the transit time because lot of logistic operators finding it difficult in order to reach the destination due to that reason. So they brought in the concept of e-way bill, that is give a document before you move the goods, so that we will be knowing from where to where the goods are being moved and which person is causing movement of goods, so that we will be in a position to check whenever we need. So this is a self-assessment kind of, so voluntarily you have to do that. And if you are transporting any goods without a valid e-way bill, then those goods are liable for confiscation. Now what we need to understand is, along with the goods, what is the documents that we need to carry if the goods are taxable goods. So first we will divide it into two: supply, not a supply. If the goods are taxable goods, okay, it is covered under supply and the goods are taxable goods, so definitely a tax invoice is required, plus a e-way bill is also required. Suppose if it is covered under supply but the goods are not taxable goods, it is are exempted goods, then what about e-way bill? E-way bill not required in case of exempted goods. Understood or not? E-way bill not required in case of exempted goods. So only in case of taxable goods e-way bill is required. What about non-taxable supplies? Exempted supplies includes non-taxable supplies for transportation of alcoholic liquor for human consumption and petroleum products. E-way bill is not required. Anyhow, there is no levy of GST on that, so e-way bill is not required. And what about not a supply? Not a supply and they are taxable goods, then a delivery challan plus a e-way bill is required. What if they are exempted goods? E-way bill is not required. So generally in case of exempted goods, even the requirement of delivery challan also shall not arise, but many people will be transporting the goods with a delivery challan. Okay, and bill of supply is not required because there is no supply in this case. So what is it we are trying to understand? So the documents that needs to be transported, so documents required, documents to be carried along with goods during movement of goods. during movement of goods. Okay, during movement of goods. What are those documents? What are those documents? So we need to divide that into two. So is it supply or not a supply? We need to check. We need to check whether it is supply, whether it is supply or not supply, not a supply. Suppose if it is supply, thereafter further we will classify it into two, that is whether these are taxable goods or exempted goods. Exempted goods includes non-taxable, okay, exempted goods. Now for services, why e-way bill is required? That is not required, only in case of goods e-way bill is required. If it is taxable goods, then that should contain invoice, tax invoice plus e-way bill. That should contain, that is we should transport tax with the goods with tax invoice plus e-way bill. Suppose if the goods are exempted goods, then in that case, so then we need only bill of supply, that is sufficient. So we don't have to take e-invoice. And suppose if it is not a supply, if it is not a supply, again divided into two, whether it is taxable goods or exempted goods. If it is taxable goods, so that good should accompany delivery challan plus e-way bill. Delivery challan plus e-way bill. So which means that even if the movement of goods does not involve supply, definitely therefore e-way bill is required, because the taxable goods are being transported from one place to another place. Now that's why. Whereas it is exempted goods. See, we can understand one more point from this, that only when the goods are taxable goods, so that requires e-way bill. If the goods are exempted goods, fully e-way bill is not required. So just the delivery challan, just the delivery challan, that is sufficient, nothing else. Okay. So this is with respect to exempted goods. Okay. Now this e-way bill needs to be given only when there is movement of goods. Suppose if the buyer is coming to our premises and he takes the delivery of the goods, and thereafter he is taking care of the transportation. So the e-way bill requirement is on him only, not on us. Okay. So we are moving the goods from one location to another location, then only e-way bill is required. Is there a movement of goods? Yes. Then only e-way bill required. Suppose if it is no e-way bill, not necessary. Yes. Are the goods exempted? Yes. Then e-way bill not required. Just now we have seen when in case of exempted goods, e-way bill not required. No, those goods are not exempted goods. Those are taxable goods. Whether your state has notified the e-way bill applicability? Yes. Now almost all states have notified here. Okay. All states have notified. That is for your information. All states notified the requirement of e-way bill. Okay. But there is some little bit of difference in the provisions here. For example, if you take West Bengal, so only when the value of the goods exceeds 1 lakh, that requires an e-way bill. But if it is the general case, if you see, 50,000 rupees is the limit. Okay. So some states, few goods, e-way bill is not required. Okay. Like that, they have given some notified goods for non-requirement of e-way bill. So this kind of provisions will differ, but almost all states have notified the e-way bill provisions. And then we need to check what is the value of the goods. Here when you take value, generally value excludes GST, but in this place when you count the value, value includes GST. Value of taxable supply. Suppose if in an invoice there is both taxable goods as well as exempted goods, take out the exempted goods. Take only the taxable goods, and that taxable goods value, you see, the value of that taxable goods, if it exceeds 50,000 rupees inclusive of GST, then e-way bill is necessary, mandatory. Suppose if the value does not exceed 50,000, then e-way bill is optional. If you want, you can, otherwise not required, because even if you are not generating the e-way bill, you are a registered person causing movement of the goods, even if you are not generating e-way bill, the transporter who is moving the goods will generate the e-way bill. Is it clear or not? See, not that e-way bill will not be there. E-way bill will be there, but only the person. So you are not required. The registered person who is causing movement of goods is not required to generate e-way bill, but the transporter will generate the e-way bill. Done. Okay. So, but with respect to two goods, that is job work, goods sent on job work, very, very important, remember. In case of goods sent on job work and in case of handicrafts, okay. In case of goods sent on job work and in case of handicrafts, e-way bill is always required. Okay. E-way bill is always required, whatever may be the case. E-way bill is required, and that particular e-way bill You know, even if the value does not exceed 50,000, okay, what are the job work and handicraft goods? Goods sent on job work and handicraft goods, okay? So then definitely e-way bill is required. Otherwise, e-way bill is required only when the value exceeds 50,000 rupees, and when we take value, that value will be inclusive of GST. That value will be inclusive of GST, okay? Then, are you a registered person? You are the one who is causing movement of goods, okay? Are you the registered person? You are a supplier. Are you the registered person? Yes. Then you will declare the details in part A. So in e-way bill, there will be two parts. The e-way bill format is form GST EWB1 is the format of the e-way bill. In that e-way bill, there will be two parts, part A and part B. Part A contains the details of the suppliers, like what is the GSTN of the supplier, GSTN of the recipient, and what is the invoice details, what is the description of the goods. All those details will be there in part A. Whereas in part B, so there will be, okay, in part B, there will be details related to the transportation, like what is the transport document, reference number, vehicle number, etc. That will be there in part B. So if you are a registered person, you are a supplier registered, then you furnish the details for the purpose of generation of e-way bill. Suppose if you are a supplier and you are unregistered, then see whether recipient is registered. Yes, recipient is registered. Then recipient is deemed to be the person causing movement of goods, okay? Recipient is deemed to be the person who is causing movement of goods. So recipient should declare the details in part A. So recipient should generate e-way bill. Suppose if both supplier and recipient are unregistered, then the primary liability will be on the transporter to furnish the details based on the, you know, transaction and generate the e-way bill. If not, alternatively, supplier and recipient also can generate e-way bill by enrolling themselves as citizen. Using their permanent account number, they can generate the e-way bill. But the liability will be on the transporter, okay? What we are trying to understand is, as per the rules, what is the liability? So supplier registered, supplier. Recipient is registered. Supplier is unregistered, recipient is registered, then on recipient. If both are unregistered, then on transporter. That is the liability, okay? To generate e-way bill. Now, what they need to do is that they need to fill the part A details. Once they fill the part A details, now we need to see whether it is an intrastate movement. Yes, within 50 kilometers. So from where to where, from the place to the transporter, okay? Whether the intrastate transport distance, that is usually we will be taking the goods to a transporter's place from our factory, and if the distance is within 50 kilometers, within the state, okay, within the state, then part B not required. Part A is required. Definitely part A is required. I'm not telling that e-way bill is not required. E-way bill is required, but no need to furnish the details in part B. Remember, only when there is movement of goods to the transporter and if the number of kilometers does not exceed 50 kilometers within the state, then part B details not required, okay. Otherwise, part B details needs to be updated. What is the time limit within which part B details needs to be entered? Okay, that is, so once the part B details are entered, once the part B details are entered, within 72 hours, the other person, that is the consignee, should accept that e-way bill. Otherwise, it is deemed to have been accepted. Suppose if we deliver it within that time, so then that time the recipient, that is the consignee, should accept the goods, accept the e-way bill in the portal, okay? So I'm just writing that point, you please make note. Consignee should accept e-way bill within 72 hours, within 72 hours from the time of generation of e-way bill or B, date of delivery, okay? So whenever we deliver it, date of delivery, so whenever that goods are delivered to that person, whichever is earlier is the time by which the consignee should accept the e-way bill. non-acceptance of e-way bill, where it should be accepted in the portal. Non-acceptance leads to deemed acceptance. Non-acceptance, note, non-acceptance leads to deemed acceptance. Non-acceptance within that time leads to deemed acceptance, okay, leads to deemed acceptance. So thereafter he cannot say I did not receive the goods, etc., and also it is considered as goods purchased by him, okay. And then what is the time limit for entering part B details after entering part A? Okay, part B details needs to be entered. Part B details needs to be entered. What is the time limit? Part B details needs to be entered within 15 days. Within 15 days from the time part A details are furnished. Part A details are entered or furnished. Is it clear? So what is this time limit of 15 days? So once part A details are entered, so to generate the e-way bill, part B needs to be updated. So part B details needs to be entered. What is the time limit for entering part B details? 15 days. And once part B is also done, e-way bill is generated. So thereafter, within 72 hours, the recipient should accept. Otherwise, or before delivery, whichever is earlier. So if not acceptance, so he is deemed to have accepted the e-way bill. Understood or not? So this 72 hours and 15 days will become a confusion. 15 days to enter the vehicle details in e-way bill. And 72 hours is once e-way bill is generated by entering the vehicle details in part B. So from there, within 72 hours, the recipient should accept. That is the point. Okay. Then next, validity of the e-way bill. See the next page. What is the validity of the e-way bill? So the validity is now amended. Previously it was 100 kilometers for every one day or part thereof. Okay. So what does it mean? For every 100 kilometers or part thereof, it is one day. For example, if the distance is 440 kilometers, so previously the validity used to be 5 days, but now that 100 kilometers have been amended to 200 kilometers. So which means that, so the validity will be, suppose if it is the same 440 kilometers, the validity will come down to 3 days. First 200 kilometers one day, next 200 kilometers one day, and thereafter part thereof it will be one day. So therefore 3 days will be taken as the validity of the e-way bill. Understood or not? So therefore, what is the validity of e-way bill? One day for every 200 kilometers or part thereof. And this is in case of other than over-dimensional cargo and other than multi-modal transportation, where one of the leg of journey involves transportation by vessel. Okay. So what is a over-dimensional cargo? Over-dimensional cargo means the tail end of the cargo will be very big. That is known as over-dimensional cargo. Okay. For example, you see this. You'll understand how a over-dimensional cargo will look like. Okay. So over-dimensional cargo will be like this, wherein the tail end of the cargo is long. Okay. So see how many tires are there. So this usually takes lot of time and they do transport only during the nights. So the journey will be only during the nights. During the mornings they will be making a halt, and only during the nights the transportation will happen so that they can comfortably go and make a turning, because for making one turning itself it will take hell lot of time for that reason. So this over dimensional cargo or multimodal transportation, where one of the leg means up to some distance by roadways and thereafter by railways, thereafter by waterways and again by roadways, like that there are multiple modes of transportation in which one leg of journey involves transportation by waterways. In these two cases, it will be one day for every 20 kilometers or part thereof. That is the validity of the e-way bill. One day for every 20 kilometers or part thereof will be taken as the validity of e-way bill. Don't forget this, okay? Suppose if there is a multimodal transportation and by roadways, railways and airways, and again by roadways. Okay, now what will be taken as the validity? In that case, it will be 1 day for every 200 kilometers or path thereof, not 20 kilometers. Okay, because not all multimodal transportation you will be taking 20 kilometers. Multimodal transportation wherein one leg of the journey should be transportation of goods by vessel, then only we will be taking 1 day for every 20 kilometers or part thereof, otherwise it will be normal only. Okay, and this validity of e-way bill will be extended within 8 hours from the expiry of the e-way bill. So what is the purpose of this validity? See, once the e-way bill is generated, automatically its validity will be counted. By that time, if you could not reach the destination, then you need to renew the e-way bill. And when you renew the e-way bill, you need to state the reason for the purpose of renewal of the e-way bill. Why you could not reach the destination on time? So it is because of the breakdown, vehicle breakdown, or it is because of some accident that has taken place in that highway. So some reason you need to mention for the purpose of that renewal. So suppose if you are not renewing, you are the transporter. So usually who will renew? Transporter will do that. Suppose if the e-way bill is not renewed, this is as good as the goods are transported without a valid e-way bill. If the goods are transported without a valid e-way bill, what will happen? Penalty will be levied. Penalty will be levied. So there will be a huge penalty that will be levied because the goods are transported without a valid document. And these goods are liable for confiscation. Liable for confiscation means the goods will be taken over by the department and they will sell those goods, and whatever money realized, it will be going into department's pocket. So they will not be sharing with you. Got it? So that is the difficulty that we have. And important point is that the validity will be counted from the midnight of the day in which e-way bill is generated till the next day midnight. For example, so today morning the e-way bill is generated. Okay, so today morning somewhere around 4 o'clock, 4 a.m. the e-way bill is generated. It will be counted from today's midnight to tomorrow's midnight. And suppose if it is generated in the afternoon, same. Suppose if it is in the evening, same. Suppose if it is at 11 p.m. then also the same. So the validity will always be counted from the midnight of that day to the midnight of the next day. Okay, so that's how the validity will be computed. So which means at any given point of time the validity will expire by midnight, by 12. So it is counted from midnight to midnight, so the validity will expire by midnight. So by 8 a.m. next day, because 8 hours, so therefore 8 a.m. by next day we need to renew the validity of the e-way bill. So that's what I have given few questions. Suppose the e-way bill is generated at 0001 hours for 140 kilometers. So 140 kilometers means now the validity will be how many days? 1 day. The validity will be 1 day. Okay. So on March 8, where the goods are transported by truck, the validity is 1 day. So previously it was 2 days and now it will be 1 day. Okay. Then first day will end on 12th midnight of March 9th. So that will be taken. Okay. That will be taken, or you can even change that to 240 kilometers. You change that to 240 kilometers so that the validity will be 2 days. For every 200 kilometers or part thereof, the validity will be 1 day. So therefore 240 kilometers, the validity will be 2 days. So the first day will end on March 9 midnight and second day will be March 10 midnight, even though it was generated somewhere early morning on March 8th. Understood? Same way, suppose if the e-way bill is generated for 150 kilometers and it is a over-dimensional cargo. So over-dimensional cargo means 20 kilometers 1 day, so 140 divided by 20, 7 days. So it will be counted. So March 8th, so 8th to 9th, 8th midnight to 9th midnight. Okay. Then 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So till midnight of March 15, it will be going. Okay. Then next, when e-way bill is not required, there are some important FAQs in this regard which we are trying to understand. When e-way bill is not at all required, e-way bill is not required in case of transportation by a non-motorized vehicle. Non-motorized vehicle means what? Bullock cart, horse cart, manual rickshaws, etc. Then the transportation do not require an e-way bill. And goods transported from port, airport or land custom station to inland container depot and container freight stations. Okay. So where these places are what we need to understand. So what is that these places are about? Okay. So whenever you wanted to import or export by waterways, what is that place? Import or export by waterways. Import or export by waterways. What is that place? What is that place? Port. Correct? So that place is port. Next. Import or export by airways. What is that place? Airport. Okay. Import or export by airways. What is that place known as airport? So that place is airport. And then import or export by land route. Import or export by roadways or railways. Okay. Roadways or railways, that place will be known as land customs station. So that place will be known as land customs station. These are the three places. Now generally the goods will be transported from this place to an inland container depot or container freight station. Inland container depot is like, you know, the place where we keep the port wherein there is no sea. So without sea, how a port will come? Deemed ports. These are known as deemed ports. Okay. So the place where there is no port, a port will be established, that is known as deemed port. That is for the purpose of import and export into that place. For example, if you take Hyderabad is not surrounded by sea, Bengaluru is not surrounded by sea, and you take Coimbatore is not surrounded by sea. And in that case, if import or export need to take place by waterways, how it can be done? So practically it is not possible. Then the importer has to go to the nearest port. Rather, they can complete all the formalities in their place itself. So the customs will establish a deemed port, that is known as inland container depot. Same way, container freight station. This inland container depot, and same way we have container freight station. So what is this container freight station? So container freight station is the place where stuffing and destuffing of the containers takes place. So for example, if you see lot of film fighting sequences will be happening in some places, okay, like containers, lot of containers they will keep. The chasing scene will be, hero will be chasing, or police will be chasing hero, or the shootout location. So that place where all the containers they will keep. So for what purpose? So stuffing and destuffing of the containers, because in a container they will be bringing goods belonging to multiple people, and these goods belonging to multiple people will be segregated or aggregated in that place. Okay, so this is for stuffing and destuffing of containers. Stuffing and destuffing of containers. So container freight station. Therefore, from port, airport or land custom station to inland container depot or container freight station. Okay. From these three places to these two places. Okay. What is that? From port, airport or land custom station to this inland container depot or container freight station, the goods are transported by a vehicle. Okay. The goods are transported by a vehicle. This is assumed to be lorry. Then, same way, from this place to this place. Okay. From container freight station or inland container depot, in case of export, the goods are transported. Okay. This do not require e-way bill. Okay. Do not require e-way bill. E-way bill not required. e-way bill not required. Okay, so that is the relaxation which is provided here. Okay, so from port, airport or land custom station to inland container depot or container freight station, e-way bill is not required. This is that next point. And then goods are transported under customs supervision or under customs control. So any goods which are imported from outside India to India, that can be taken to a customs warehouse without payment of customs duty. So this transportation from the port or airport or land customs station to the customs warehouse will be under the supervision of the customs. Due to that reason, that do not require a e-way bill. That is the third point. So first point, non-motorized vehicle. Second, from port, airport or land customs station to container freight station or inland container depot or reverse. And then if the goods are transported to the customs warehouse under customs supervision and control, and then transit cargo to Nepal and Bhutan. Nepal and Bhutan are landlocked countries, and this point is there in exemptions also. That is, if you provide any cargo handling services or if you provide any services in relation to transit cargo to Nepal and Bhutan, those services are exempted from GST. Like that, we have an exemption in the miscellaneous exemptions in services. Okay, so what is this point about, you know, transportation of goods? So transit cargo to Nepal and Bhutan. See, Nepal and Bhutan are landlocked countries, which means you cannot import it by waterways. So now there is an MOU between Nepal and Bhutan, Indian government, that Nepal and Bhutan government or any person in Nepal and Bhutan will be importing the goods to a port in India. From that port in India to Nepal and Bhutan, the goods will be going by the roadways. So this is known as transit cargo to Nepal and Bhutan. We have one point in GST exemption, that is, so whenever service are provided in relation to transit cargo to Nepal and Bhutan, it is exempted. Now there is a connecting point here. What is that? That transit cargo, when you are taking it in roadways, that do not require e-way bill. That is this point. And then movement of goods related to Ministry of Defense. So Ministry of Defense will be giving some goods to us, so for transporting it, so we are doing it, so that do not require a e-way bill. And empty cargo container, so there won't be any goods inside that. So it is the empty cargo containers that are being transported, that also do not require. Apart from this, there are some notified goods also. Okay, there are some notified goods and some more points. So what is this point number 7 about? See, it is interesting point. That is, so generally we will be taking a lorry to a weigh bridge. So for the purpose of weighing the lorry, so that if you know the weight of the lorry without goods and with goods, so you know the weight of the goods. So first they will take the lorry to the weigh bridge without goods. Definitely that do not require a e-way bill. Why that do not require a e-way bill? Because there is no goods inside that lorry. So therefore that do not require a e-way bill. Now that lorry will come back to the factory. So in the factory we will load the goods, and thereafter that lorry will go to the weigh bridge. So now we will weigh the lorry with the goods, so that weight of the lorry with goods minus weight of the lorry without goods, you will know the weight of the goods. So now this lorry which is taking the goods now to the weigh bridge, okay, so whether that require an e-way bill? No, there is a relaxation provided that do not require an e-way bill, provided the weigh bridge is located within 20 kilometers from the supplier's location. Means the movement is for a distance of 20 kilometers only, up to 20 kilometers, not more than that. If the distance is within the 20 kilometers, that do not require an e-way bill. Okay, then goods are transported by railways. So when goods are transported by railways, no need to accompany e-way bill along with the goods. But when it reaches the destination, the consignee comes and takes over the goods now. So the consignee has to present the e-way bill. Then only the goods will be handed over by railways. See, that is, you are the consignor. You are the consignor. I am the consignee. You are handing over the goods to the Indian Railways. Now, you no need to give the e-way bill there. So those goods will be transported without an e-way bill. Now I am the consignee. So Indian Railways will give the goods to me only if I produce the e-way bill which you have raised to me. Okay, which you have generated. So that e-way bill I need to present here. Then only I will be getting the goods. Okay, that is this. Then provided, then we have one more point related to railways. Suppose if the goods are transported by railways, and those goods are belonging to central government or state government or local authority, that do not require e-way bill. Okay. Then goods specifically specified as exempt from e-way bill by the states. I told you already. So states have given some notified goods. With respect to those notified goods, e-way bill not required. And overall, in general also, this is state specific. Point number 9 is state specific. Now point number 10 is general. Overall, these notified goods do not require EWA bill. What are they? LPG for supply to the household and that is domestic, non-domestic exempted category. Which cylinders? See, there are two types of cylinders, red color one and the blue color one. So red color cylinders, transportation with gas. Suppose if it is without gas, no EWA bill. Why no EWA bill? Empty cargo containers do not require EWA bill. So if it is filled with gas and if it is red color cylinders, that do not require an EWA bill. If it is a blue color cylinder filled with gas, that requires an EWA bill. Kerosene oil. Sir, gas will not be coming under taxable supply, no? No, yes, it will come under taxable supply. So gas is not a non-taxable supply, okay? Then kerosene sold under PDS. So kerosene will be given to various ration shops. So that movement of kerosene also do not require an EWA bill. Sir, kerosene is also non-taxable supply. No, kerosene will be taxable supply. Then postal baggage. So Department of Post, when the parcels are being sent, so that also do not require EWA bill. And natural and cultured pearls, then jewelry, goldsmith and silversmith wares. So because if that transportation requires an EWA bill and if we submit the detail in which vehicle we are transporting jewelry, so then if someone hacks the EWA bill server, it will be easy for him to become a billionaire, correct or not? So therefore you know from where to where it is going, at what time it is leaving and when it will reach the destination, and you know what is the quantity of the gold that is being transported with vehicle number, then easily, you know, what is that? Money haste we can do, or doom like that we can do, you understood or not? So therefore easily we can now loot that money for that purpose only, that do not require an EWA bill. And used personal and household effects. Used personal and household effects means, so that like we are shifting our house from one location to another location. That shifting of house do not like that goods are used household goods that do not require EWA bill. These are the notified goods, okay? So now what they will ask is, in MCQ they will give, so in which of the following cases EWA bill is not required? In that four cases, so they will ask you to identify like that, okay? Then, whether EWA bill is required if the movement of goods is not for supply? Yes, irrespective of whether it is supply or not a supply, EWA bill is required. Then, whether 50,000 limit is for taxable goods or exempted goods, only taxable goods. Suppose if in the same invoice both taxable goods and exempted goods are there, take out exempted goods, only take taxable goods if its value exceeds 50,000. You know, that do not if it exceeds 50,000, that only require EWA bill. While computing invoice value, whether GST to be included, yes, GST to be included. Who may generate EWA bill? Registered person causing movement of goods. Who is the registered person causing movement of goods? So supplier, okay. Suppose if there is an unregistered person, then the recipient. Then the recipient, otherwise transporter. Already we saw this point. Whether transporter is required to generate EWA bill, if the supplier has not generated EWA bill because the value of the goods does not exceed 50,000. For example, say I am one supplier and like me, there are 10 different suppliers who handed over the goods to the transporter and we did not generate EWA bill because each supplier's value of goods does not exceed 50,000. But in aggregate, if you see, the overall value which are transported by the transporter in a single vehicle exceeds 50,000. Nah? So therefore, that requires an EWA bill. Understood? Then who will generate EWA bill? Transporter will generate EWA bill. How many EWA bill can be generated in case of bill to ship to transaction? So in bill to ship to transaction, there are two supplies. For example, you placed an order with me to deliver the goods to your customer. Now I delivered the goods to your customer. So for me, you are the billing address, so I will raise invoice to you. Now you will raise invoice to the shipping address, correct or not? Even though there are two supplies involved in a bill to ship to transaction, but only one EWA bill is sufficient. One EWA bill is sufficient. So the EWA bill with bill to ship to option needs to be selected. Is there any disqualification for generation of a EWA bill? Yes, there is a disqualification. What is that? If you are not filing returns for two consecutive tax periods. So what is that? So two consecutive GSTR ones, two consecutive GSTR 3B, or two consecutive CMP 8. Okay. So CMP 8 is what? Composition scheme. Composition scheme return. Okay. So suppose if it is not filed, GSTR 1 or GSTR 3B, GSTR 1 or GSTR 3B or CMP 8. If not generated, that do not require an EWA bill. Understood? means in the sense like that, that is not there, then e-way bill cannot be made. If e-way bill cannot be made, goods cannot be transported. Against that GSTIN, e-way bill cannot be generated either as a consignor or a consignee or a transporter. For example, I did not file return for 2 quarters. Okay. Say I'm like 2 months. Okay. GSTR1, I did not file for 2 months. Now, against my GSTIN, if you enter in consignor name, consignor GSTIN, if you enter my GSTIN, error message will come. If my name is entered as consignee, error message will come. If my name is mentioned as transporter, error message will come. You understood or not? So, because against that person, you cannot generate a e-way bill. Okay. So, GSTR 1, 2 or CMP 8, offset GSTN not filed for 2 consecutive tax periods. Then, if goods are transported in public transport or by railways or airways, how vehicle number will be entered? So, vehicle number cannot be entered because it is difficult to ascertain the vehicle number. So, then those transporters will give a document reference number. For example, if you hand over the goods to the railways, which aircraft they are sending, you don't need. But they will give a reference number, airway bill number. That is sufficient. When you hand over the goods to a shipping company, they transport it by a vessel. We don't know which vessel. And same way, when you hand over the goods to a public transport, we don't know which bus they will be using for the purpose of transporting. But these people will be giving a document, and that document reference number, if you enter, that will be sufficient. Can the goods be transported in one vehicle up to a distance and another vehicle for the remaining distance? Yes, we can do that. And for this, we need to update the Part B details. Part B details is there, now that Part B details, vehicle number needs to be updated, add record. Okay. So these are the various FAQs that you need to keep in mind for the purpose of e-way bill. So this concept block number 12, we have completed GST practitioner e-way bill. So till last attempt, I didn't focus much on this. So, but this attempt, I have given lot of details related to the e-way bill because so the requirement of CA exams is increasing for December 21. So gradually, because already they have exhausted many questions repeatedly. So due to that reason, okay. Now, let's see some questions in the practice manual related to this. See the practice manual related to this GST practitioner and e-way bill miscellaneous provisions. So take your volume 2 book and page number 116. Descriptive questions in RTP May 2020, they gave one question. Discuss the correctness of the following statements. Once generated, a e-way bill cannot be cancelled. True or false? No, it is false. It can be cancelled within 24 hours. Within 24 hours from the generation of e-way bill, it can be cancelled. Actually, it's a loophole. So we can generate the e-way bill and the goods can be transported. If the goods do not reach the destination on time, so then what will happen? So if the goods reaches the destination within 24 hours and no one identified that, you can delete the e-way bill as if the goods are not transported. Okay. So e-way bill can be cancelled within 24 hours from the date of its generation. Okay. Then e-way bill generated in one state is valid in another state. Yes. So there is no state specific e-way bill. E-way bill is common for all the states. Then it is mandatory to furnish the details of conveyance in Part B of e-way bill. So November 2020 for 3 marks they have asked. Comment on the validity of the above statement. See in Part B what details needs to be furnished. We need to furnish the details of vehicle, but if the goods are transported by public transport or by railways or by airways, okay, so then in that case, instead of entering the vehicle details, the transport document number needs to be entered. Also, in case if the transportation distance is within 50 kilometers, from the place of business of the consignor to the business of the transporter or the transporter to the business of the consignee. So in these two cases, from where to where? Consignor to the transporter's place, transporter's place to the consignee's place. If the distance does not exceed 50 kilometers, then vehicle details not required, but e-way bill is required. Okay, then question number 3. Mr. Shah, a consignor, is required to move goods from Ahmedabad, Gujarat to Nadiad, Gujarat. He appoints Mehta transporter for movement of goods. Mehta transporter moves the goods from Ahmedabad to, okay, this same place within Gujarat. And for completing the movement of goods from Kedar to Nadiad, Gujarat, Mehta transporter now hands over the goods to Parikh transporter. So what happened? From one transporter, not one vehicle to another vehicle by the same transporter, one transporter to another transporter, whether another e-way bill is required? No, same e-way bill. So what is to be done is that, okay, so before transfer of goods to the another transporter, so part B details, okay. So Mr. Shah, on receipt of goods, who has filed part A of e-way bill or Mehta transporter, can before transfer and further movement update the details of conveyance in part B. Okay. So on reaching that place, that person, okay, can assign the said e-way bill. So one transporter can assign the e-way bill to another transporter. That another transporter, this is known as assignment of the e-way bill by one transporter to another transporter. That another transporter will update the part B details. Okay. So this is asked in November 19 new syllabus for 5 marks. Understood? So this you mark as important. It's an important one. Then question number 4. So recent exam, Jan 21 exam. Agni Limited, a registered supplier, wishes to transport cargo by road between two cities situated at a distance of 368 kilometers. So now, is it over-dimensional? No. Normal. Both they are asking. Okay. Both they are asking. Calculate the validity. If it is over-dimensional cargo or otherwise both. Suppose if it is over-dimensional cargo. So 368 divided by 20. 18.4 fraction, any fraction will be taken as next number 19. So 19 days will be taken as the validity. Suppose if it is other than over dimensional cargo, 200 kilometers. So 2 days. Now it is 200 kilometers. So 2 days will be taken as the validity of the e-way bill. Understood? So these are the types of questions, theoretical and practical questions, which are asked on this concept in miscellaneous provisions. Okay. So with this e-way bill is over. And over to the next concept.